could say, though the analogy is different, but it is quite sumptuous. And another fascinating fact today is, like, Mr. Ashwini Taneja has been on our platform thrice, that every time we come out, especially on the law of PMLA, beyond law CLC, then in that eventuality, we have always been having people with different platforms of different knowledge. Once we had two judges, one Mr. Anil Dave, a former judge of the Supreme Court of India, along with him was Justice Vineet Kothari, a judge of the Madras High Court. And the common point running between them, common thread running, was that all were chartered accountants and men of immense knowledge. Today we have three speakers of different diverse knowledge, but common thread again running amongst them is that undoubtedly that they're men of immense knowledge, but they believe that knowledge cannot be restricted to one person. The more they share, the more the nation grows. And they personally feel that once the foundation of any knowledge is good, then the nation develops in its right perspective. We are talking that we should have a nation which has a future vision. And future vision only is when there is a decimation of knowledge. As they say, each one plant one. Here on this platform, we have not believed that each one should plant one.
Number likh ke lena, number.
But because there are a large number of participants on the platform, we are also live on the Facebook. And Mr. Suresh Prabhu's face is all live. So as they say, I was just recollecting that there was used to be a common mathematics question. Let's assume one sheep is having the grass of particular level, and let's assume how many 100 sheep will do. So it's the same way. Let's assume we have a people of 5,000 people watching us live. So 5,000 people for 1 hour will be having an immense knowledge session. They would be enriched. Before, amongst us, we have Mr. Suresh Prabhu, who is 4 times member of parliament from the Lok Sabha, and he's also the Rajya Sabha MP. It shows the fact that for a person, it's very, very difficult, or for a common man, even with the political ambitions, to win an election once. But if a person wins 4 times, and then he's nominated to Rajya Sabha, Rajya Sabha nomination ipso facto means that he's acknowledged for his knowledge. And his winning of elections on a Lok Sabha means that he's a man of masses. And a person who is a combination of Rajya Sabha as well as Lok Sabha, it shows that he's grounded to the people at large, and Rajya Sabha shows people also acknowledge him for his intellectual knowledge. And for that reason, if one goes to the resume of a Suresh Prabhu as a normal inquisitive human being, especially like we are Punjabi, they say Punjabi means he will acknowledge the facts later. First, he will try to, more like a Google, he would like to see what is the insights. If one starts reading the resume itself, as we commonly say that people, we have always brought people with immense knowledge. You can even take 1.5 hour only explaining the biodata, the knowledge, what he has dissipated during entire time. Mr. Suresh Prabhu is a former railway minister, civil aviation minister, and so on and so on. He's a chartered accountant by profession. His knowledge as a chartered accountant also is to the such effect that people wish to learn from him. Each word he speaks itself is a worth gold that one can only seep in and just cherish it. As we said on the previous date, that once this is a goal, thankfully, any participant who is here coming out here, he doesn't get the notice that there is a money laundering at your end because you are having knowledge which is worth gold. And amongst us, we have Honorable Mr. Justice Manmohan Singh, who is a former judge of Delhi High Court. He has been the chairman of the PMLA, the key topic which we are discussing today. And he is also presently the chairman of the intellectual property. And I believe that once he is with the intellectual property, it goes without saying that he is the right person to be chosen for the intellectual property. I would say It is not for the purposes of controlling the intellectual property. By his coming on this platform, it shows that his intellect carries the property itself out here. That's the worth of Justice Manmohan Singh. And the word Manmohan Singh itself is, Jo man ko hi moh jaye, wo Manmohan Singh. And then we have amongst us, Mr. Ashwini Taneja. I could have stopped saying that Mr. Taneja is thrice on our platform. He needs no introduction. But whenever he comes, he brings a different audience because he is just like a Pied Piper of Hamelin, what we read in our childhood days. He came and he took the children to the well itself. But here, what is the well? The well is of deep knowledge of insights which he gives. And that is a well where people don't want to come out because it's a platform where we'll all share our knowledge. And again, the motto of sharing is caring. And our motto beyond law CLC would be mean that we do not just discuss law. We also discuss anything which is beyond law. And we have a politician, a judge, and a lawyer, Mr. Ashwini Taneja, who is also a former ITAT member. I think it's one of the best platforms where we can discuss on anti-money laundering law and difference in law and practice. It's a topic which on the first brush itself looks very fascinating. It's very rare that we can take a topic from its origin to the end to conclude that the intent of the legislature is different. That is what is contemplated in the books and how it is being practiced. The finer nuances from people of the stature of Mr. Suresh Prabhu, Justice Manmohan Singh, and Ashwini Taneja will help us to unfold the areas, the gray areas, which are in the minds of anyone, number one. Number two, the persons who do not have the insights of PMLA, but yes, it's a topic for any professional or any person because it's not restricted to professionals. It is also a person who is having immense wealth and he feels that he could be in a loop on the wrong side of law by not having insight. And let's assume that there's someone who is also right. He also feels that he should have the insights that sometimes, as we were earlier discussing, somebody is looped in the law of PMLA. Then is he actually a victim? Or once we hear three intellectual people, and then we have Mr. Khemka and Mr. Das, who will further give insights. I am reminded that when we have a platform of 5-3 originally on the dais and then two more, it will be just akin that it is just like Panch Pandav who will give the knowledge and it will be an immense knowledge to be cherished, not only for today, for all times to come. I think I shouldn't be coming in between three intellectual people and people will say that two wise people were talking. Then the third just came in. Then the fourth person asked, just like Mr. Khemka, he asked Mr. Prabhu, who is he? He said he's otherwise. Thank you, sir. Over to you, Mr. Suresh Prabhu. We are enamored that you have joined us. We are humbled by the way you have accepted our invitation. We are all humbled by all three of you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Introduction of sir I wanted to give before sir starts.
Yes.
Vikas bhai, you forgot to mention, Suresh sir is our Sherpa. He is popularly known as, chosen by our Honorable Prime Minister, popularly known as G20 Sherpa. And this is very contextual thing in today's discussion because the G20 summit in which this law with regard to anti-money laundering is going to be a special topic is being hosted by India. And under the all, guidance and supervision of and leadership and representation of Honorable Shri Suresh Prabhu. And we are sure under his guidance, this law will take its dimensions, not only in India, but at global platform also. So I will not come in the way and we present to you Honorable Shri Suresh Prabhu. Thank you, sir. Sir, please.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Taneja ji. I'm very honored by the fact that none other than Justice Manmohan Singh ji will be actually participating in this. And then we have got this distinguished Khemka ji, also Mandya ji and all others are going to be actually going to really enrich the discussion that is going to follow soon after my talk because they will be enriching it. I'll be rather making it poorer. So they'll be doing it the job when actually I stop speaking and then they'll take it from me. As you know, all the world, the big challenge of dealing with this aspect of economic offenses, and that is the money laundering part of it. Actually, originally, the people were worried about the effect of illicit trade, maybe in drugs, ammunition, or many other forms, which actually the money earned from there was now getting into the real economy by layering or by money laundering. And therefore, this topic became a very hot, important topic. And it is worldwide, there is actually a growing concern about this. And therefore, rather than going into the PMLA part of it, which all of you are so expert in dealing with, let me just give a flavor of it from what Tanejaji, my dear friend, mentioned about the G20 aspect of it. You know, G20 is a grouping, as you know, of 80 countries with 86% of the global GDP. Of course, now the global GDP itself is plummeting, so therefore, but share will still remain. And the problem that G20 faces is to deal with some of the global challenges. I must thank our Honorable Prime Minister Narendra Modi, because he has been spearheading this anti-money laundering issues in the global forums very duly. And that's a very large agenda. One is to deal with economic offenders when they flee the country where they commit the offense and try to take a refuge in some other country which offers them some sort of security. And therefore, the Prime Minister Modi's contention been that why don't you all countries in the world try to agree that an economic offense, if once it is committed in any other country, the world itself will take note of it, and then therefore they will apprehend a culprit, and then they'll to deport as well as to face the consequences. At the same time, while money laundering is important, there are other aspects of the economic offenses. Maybe really related, not directly related to this, but something which we call as a chartered accountant, which Mr. Taneja is a very distinguished member of the institute, is what is called as BEPS, Base Erosion and Profit Sharing. But what happens is the taxation, where it should really take place in the country where the profit accrued, and therefore, if you really do not have a proper international system to deal with this, then probably the taxes will escape, the income will escape being taxed at the right place. Now, this has again assumed a different proportion, what you call normally in Indian context, a transfer pricing issue. Because if one country, one company has multiple operations, or one group has multiple companies, and they therefore try to put their profits in different companies by just using the mode of transfer pricing. Because it all depends upon where the end product is going to be sold to the market. That's where the profits will be taxed. Now in India, because of GST, finally at the level of consumption, taxes will be collected. But transfer pricing ensures that you can actually place and allow taxation to be, to some extent, reduced by way of playing with the various provisions of it. So on an international scale, the base erosion profit sharing assumes great importance, particularly when we have got global supply chains, global value chains, where for the end product may be assembled, maybe an iPhone in one country, but the different components of it may be sourced from different layers. That's why how that will go into tax. Now, this then is not directly money laundering issue, but this is something to deal with the international dimension of the economic law. PMLA has been passed by the Indian Parliament, has been amended from time to time, and now we have a lot of evidence available, that is efficacy, as well as the type of shortcomings that might come into it. But when we deal with economic offenses per se, there are different dimensions to it. Like in PMLA, the whole idea is that wherever money is ill-gotten for some sort of a source which is not really allowed by the law, and then it is converted into some form wherein it now changes its color. So how do you prevent it? How do you acquisition of property coming out of the ill-gotten wealth should be properly treated? So various aspects of that are dealt with. And as my friend said in the beginning, the intention of the legislation may be one, but when it is implemented, how it gets implemented is something else. So is there any dichotomy? Is there any difference between the intention and the actual practice of it? Is something which all of you as experts will, I'm sure, will be pointing out. And it will be my duty as a member of parliament to take it back to the legislature and see how best it can be addressed. But as I was saying, the whole agenda in G20 to deal with economic offenses per se, to deal with such issues which deprives the country from its legitimate revenues because of the way the global businesses are transacted. And now again, new dimension will be added to it, will be e-commerce, where e-commerce should be taxed. E-commerce again passes through various stages, and ultimately you buy a product in India, but it may be passing through various geographical borders, custom borders, and eventually therefore how that should be taxed is an issue. And that is something which the world is grappling with today. How do you deal with issues related to international taxation, which again, if not observed properly, will assume a role of an economic offense. And therefore, economic offenses per se cannot be dealt with unless we have a national legislation like the PMLA. But we also understand that unless the national legislation has a limitation, because that can be implemented only in a sovereign territory where the country has a sovereign power to implement it. But the dimension of that offense may go beyond a territory of a national boundary. And therefore, how do you deal with such issues will also assume important. As Mr. Taneja-ji was saying, India will be hosting in 2022 the first time the G20 summit. So India will be the president for G20.
Sorry to interrupt you. And Suresh-ji, sorry to interrupt you. Could you just slightly come closer, because some people are writing on the chat box, the voice is cracking. I'm sorry that I've interrupted you.
No, I know. So I'm just saying that 2022, India will be hosting it. And at that time will be a good opportunity to bring all such big talent that is available now, who will be contributing to this debate and discourse on cases. How can we, as India, take a lead in dealing with economic offenses globally? How can we create an international system which can address the issue very effectively? And what is that roadmap one must have to make it happen? I think that's what will be a very good input, that you can give it to me, which I can take it back to the G20 community and actually work on those issues. So I will stop here only because we are seeing such great experts who are going to talk about it. So I would be guided by your inputs. I have some other webinar to attend, but I will definitely take this because this is all recorded, like Facebook Live, so I can listen to it a little later. But thank you very much for inviting me. And let me assure you one thing, that we will work as partners, because such great intellectual capital that is going to display a little later is the one which can actually provide light as to how we should progress in such matters. So thank you very much. And thank you, my friend, for giving this introduction as well as putting me into such galaxy of people who will be speaking on the subject. Thank you very much. And thank you for inviting me.
What a wonderful assurance given by sir that we all will be working as partners. So that means everybody's voice here will be heard, will be very useful. So whatever we will be deliberating, whatever we will be discussing, that whatever the problems people are facing, on the one hand, everybody wants to implement the law, but on the other hand, when the enforcement of the law is done, it is noted that some gap comes up between the intention of the parliament and the enforcement agencies and the way law is implemented. So all those things we will point out today. We will try to describe them in a more candid manner, as more as possible. And then we'll put forth before Suresh sir, so that it can reach to the right channels and the fair implementation of the law can take place, so that each of us can become contributor to the growth of the economy. Very well said, sir. And we are really thankful for that.
Suresh-ji, we are falling short of words, despite the fact that we know everyone has 24 hours. But how one manages the time, that is paramount. First, I said that you came at 6 when it was the time 6. That first lesson is learned. Then, despite the fact that you have a hectic schedule, yet you squeeze in. I'm reminded of the famous quote that they say time is like a gas. If you give an open vessel, it will keep on expanding and you cannot control it. But if you contract it, then you will have in the vessel in the shape you want. And you have funneled that time in the right perspective. I'm quite sure that your presence itself triggers of the right issue, and you're saying that what we say here, you will put it across to the men who matter. And men who matters is one of you. And we couldn't have called something better, where we wanted to speak something and there could be the message conveyed. Then they say strike when the iron is hot. And iron is hot to mean state therein that it gives the best result. So once we have you amongst us, we feel that we have actually struck when the iron is hot. And amongst us, we have Justice Manmohan Singh, He needs no further introduction. His insights would be the right thing, which will be, we will take a thing forward, and then Mr. Taneja, as usual, will come on his own flow. Thank you, sir. Thank you for giving us the entire time, Mr. Suresh Prabhu. We have no words to express our gratitude. Over to Mr. Manmohan Singh.
Thank you. Good evening to all. Many, many thanks from Prabhuji. I have learnt a lot. Prabhuji has given overall picture, and I really appreciate it. And certain things today I have come to know. I will just first explain that how this act has come. That is the Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002. You know, I joined the practice as advocate in April 1980. You know, at that time, all the offenses, economic offenses, or cheating, or other matters were being dealt in two sides. One is on civil side, one is on criminal side. Civil side, basically, people used to file the suit for recovery of the amount, suit for cheating, suit for defamation. And on the criminal side, IPC was working. It was noticed by the government, it was noticed by the courts, it was noticed by the advocate that many times when the ultimately matter is decided in favor of the state or in favor of the private party who has been cheated, the person is missing. The person is missing, or he has already disposed of the property, or he has purchased the Benami property from that tainted amount. So on the civil side, there was a provision, that is Order 38, Rule 1 to Rule 4. The set provision is attachment before judgment. The person basically who has to recover the amount to take action against the party concerned under Order 38 by moving the petition before the court, that here is the person who is the offender of economic offenses. Here is the person who has cheated me. Here is the person who is involved in involving cheating. So basically, his property should be attached, or he should be restrained not to go outside India. But on the criminal side, there was no provision, IPC state provision. So government thought, why not basically we should bring a law on this aspect, that till the final case decided on the criminal side under the IPC, his property should be attached and he should be dealt with the separate act, that is the Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002. So this act has come, and you will come to know that there were very few cases at that time, very few cases till 1994 or 2014 or 2015, because many times it has been seen that the chairman used to come one or two times before the appellate tribunal to hear the matters. But after 15, I have noticed that plenty of work is added there. I can tell you that PMLA court now deal with the Benami properties. They are dealing with the FEMA. They are dealing with the narcotic. They are dealing with all the cases of money laundering. So plenty of work is there. More than 6,000-7,000 cases are pending before the appellate authority. This is the overall picture. This law has come, and rightly so, because something should be preserved till the matter is decided. And side by side, case may also go under these acts, before the special court. This was the scheme of the act. In the act itself, that is PMLA, there is a schedule of offenses where there is a complete chart which case can be dealt under the PMLA. The ED is authorized to attach the property under Section 5 of the act, and it is also empowered to search and seizure and retain the property and record within the meaning of Section 70 to 21 of the Act. We must basically, we must see that it is a special act. And it, all the provisions in the Acts are very stringent provision. These provisions have to be applied very strictly. The meaning of these provisions cannot be changed. Different meaning cannot be given. So being a special act, the ED is empowered to attach the property. If we read Section 5, it is clearly mentioned that the attachment of the property involves in money laundering. These are the punchline of Section 5, because that is the starting point, that the property must be, the property involved must be from money laundering. And other condition is that the person must have in possession of proceed of crime by way of property, cash, by way of property, by way of cash, by way of shares, and other movable and immovable property where he is likely to dispose of. These things basically must see the IO at that time. And before passing of the order, he must have material in his hand after the investigation. And investigation can only start if the charge sheet is filed under the IPC, Section 173 of IPC, or any written complaint. Before passing the order, material must be discussed in the reason to believe and why this property is being attached. Because under the mandatory provision, it must be in writing, and it has to be disclosed by the IO that if the property is not attached, the proceed of crime may be concealed. If these satisfactions are not there, the attachment order is an illegal order. Now, during the course of the pendency of so many matters, it was noticed by the government that many people, like, I don't want to explain, everybody knows the name, they were cheating the banks, they were on the basis of the bank guarantee, or they are taking the government money in illegal manner, or they are taking the loan from the banks and they are running away. Whenever they come to know that something is going to happen, they will run away. So second proviso was added, where the ED is given power to attach the property even without pendency of charge sheet under Section 173 IPC. So procedure here in the Section 17 to 21 is also the remain the same, and it has to be satisfied that in second proviso, that why basically property is being attached without the charge sheet, because it is a very risky proviso. Suppose somebody, one partner wants to settle the score with the another partner, and he can file the FIR, because FIR cannot be denied as per the full bench of the Supreme Court, that anybody will make prima facie case before the police has to register the FIR. And based on the FIR, suppose the police will register or attach the property against another partner, it will be totally basically misuse of the power. Therefore, in second proviso, if somebody will read under Section 5, it clearly says that this provision can be invoked only in emergency purposes. If party, like, I don't want to take the name, very big names are there, if somebody will come to know that here is a person who has taken the money of the property, and he has booked the ticket, or he has entered into an agreement with the third party, and he will run away within 2-3 days. And as far as the charge sheet is concerned, there is no limitation by the police for filing the charge sheet. It may take some time, it may take some years. So in the emergency provision, the attachment can be done even without filing the charge sheet, barely on the basis of the FIR. But basically, I feel that IAS should exercise this discretion very carefully, and reason to believe separately has to be given why this exercise is being done by the officer under the special circumstances. I agree with Mr. Prabhuji that there are so many amendments as per situation, and many amendments I agree. Explanations are also given. Many explanations I have noticed that those are not gel with the provision. Those explanations are added as per the circumstances, as per the judgment given by the High Court in order to like section 45, I don't want to say that although judgments are there, but amendments are made, explanations are also given. And in the earlier act, it is pertinent to mention that if the accused is acquitted in predicated offense, the property ceased to exist. But now amendment of various provisions in section 5 as well as in section 8 state that PMLA is an independent act. Even the accused is acquitted under the IPC provision, the proceeding against the party under the PMLA may continue. It is a very debatable point. Many judgments are there, contrary judgments by the various high courts, and ultimately now this matter is sub judice before the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court will decide, and once the person is acquitted, what are the consequences? Now, if the attachment order is passed, then the matter is referred to the adjudicating authority for confirmation. There is a complete procedure under Section 5 for filing the response and reply. Once the adjudicating authority confirms the attachment, ED is to file the charge sheet before the special court, where the proceeding of predicated offences are already pending. Now there are two routes. One is basically if party wants to litigate with the ED for attachment of property because of the reason that subsection 4 of section 8, the ED is entitled to take the possession of the property. If he wants to take up the matter before the appellant tribunal, he can file the appeal immediately under section 26 of the act and get the stay with a condition or without condition. But at the same time, he has also to contest the matter before the special court, where the trial is to be conducted in both the sides, in IPC offences as well as PML offences. So the special court will ultimately decide the matter after trial. Now, as far as section 26 of appeal is concerned, the said appeal is only pertaining to the confirmation of the order by the adjudicating authority. The adjudicating authority will confirm the attachment. The appellant tribunal will just decide whether the attachment was valid attachment or it is not a valid attachment. Either the authority will set aside the order or confirm the order. If the order is confirmed, then basically the aggrieved party has a right to file the appeal under section 42 of the PMLA Act. So these are the basically provision where we have to, same procedure is to be followed under section 17 to 21. These are the provision which are very relevant, section 5 and 17. Many amendments are made. I am of the opinion that now time has come. Many explanations are added, many amendments are made. There is a little bit confusion also. One compact act should come. This act should be repealed and everything should be added after the debate of the parliament, so that systematically it is to be incorporated in the act, because it has a very wide impact in future. And I totally agree with Mr. Prabhuji, whatever he has mentioned. And I agree that it is necessary, this act must be necessary in order to curb the corruption and to improve the economy, as well as the menace of the drug crime and for attachment of property. These steps are very much necessary under this act. But my opinion is that check and balances in all the institutions are very much necessary. If stringent provisions are added in any act, if the penalties are used against a person, being a special act, in addition to general law already available, because it is a special act, it has been basically, it is in addition to the general law. So there are few points. I will give my suggestion, because I have seen so many judgment, I have seen so many provision, I have seen so many act under this law. The first point is proceed of crime. Now, the proceed of crime means that the property must be purchased from the tainted money. There is a dispute regarding section 2U that the property can also be attached of the third party of the value thereof. This is a provision. It is mentioned in section 2U. I will just read one line. Section 2U. Schedule offenses or the value of any property. No doubt. Although everybody has a different opinion. But the point here is only this much, that the authority as well as the IO must first of all identify the proceed of crime. How much is the proceed of crime? No doubt, I agree. If somebody has invested the money in some property of the tainted amount, and property has increased its value, and I agree that the original money proceed of crime, as well as the increase of the value of the money, is a proceed of crime. Suppose somebody has invested in share market and share value is increased, and profit will also come as a proceed of crime. Similarly, if the value of the property is decreased, the remaining amount can be recovered from the party concerned. But at the same time, one cannot say, suppose the person is having two pockets. One basically, in one pocket, clean money is there, and in another pocket, proceed of crime is there. The ED or the IO is only entitled to attach the proceed of crime, not the entire money which is lying in two pockets. You know, so I say that the target should be on proceed of crime. The time has gone now that just for the sake of 100 rupees, the property worth 1,000 rupees cannot be attached because of the reason that each and every order of the ED, each and every order of the adjudicating authority, each and every order of the appellate tribunal has to be examined by the higher court. It is a matter of property. The matter cannot be closed where the adjudicating authority will give the reason. It has to be examined that here is a proceed of crime, whether the profit is made from them. Profit will also come the proceed of crime. If the property is attached more than the proceed of crime, then basically there will be problem, because the party will challenge by filing of the writ petition or by filing of the appeal of the higher court, and higher court will examine as per merit of the case. The higher court will not see. The high court will definitely identify the proceed of crime, and they will say, yes, here is a proceed of crime, secure this amount, or if any profit is made, secure that profit also, but rest of the property is released. Sometime I have noticed in many cases that if the matter will go to the higher court, high court, or the division bench of the high court, when they have seen that the proceed of crime is 100 rupees, no profit is made, or if the profit is made for 50 rupees, it will come to 150, and property of 10,000 is attached, they quash everything. Why basically we should take the risk? Risk should not be taken. I advise IO to identify the pursuit of crime, and they should attach only that property. And secondly, and that property, because Section 5.1 is very clear, it says if the property is involved in money laundering, suppose assuming the accused party has spent the money, or he has thrown the money in the Arabian tea, or he has played a gamble and he has lost entire money, it has to be attached with the other property of the accused. Suppose the accused has no other property, then basically I feel that the property of grandfather or property of maternal uncle or property of bhuwa cannot be attached, because of he is the brother, because brother has committed the offense, therefore property of relation should be attached. That is, unless some link and nexus is there. If link and nexus is there, it can be attached. Otherwise, it cannot be attached. So I see that the person who is handling the matter must be aware, because matter will go to the higher court. And if suppose the authority is totally failed to recover the amount directly or indirectly, he has no property, he is totally become a beggar, then it is a bad luck. You know, there is a provision in Court of Civil Procedure also. Suppose somebody takes the money from the bank and he has eaten the money. He has no other resources. He has no property. Money cannot be recovered. So he has to go to the jail. 6 months imprisonment is there under the provision of Order 21. You can't say that property of somebody else will be attached unless without any link and nexus. So one should be very careful. Secondly, reason to believe. Reason to believe, I see, I've been seeing, and I advise the IOs and authorities also, that crystal cut reason to believe should be given. You know, it is not necessary that the officer must give the reason to believe for 20 pages, 30 pages, or 50 pages. Reason to believe maybe in 2 pages, 1.5 pages. You have to write down only there are fundamental principle that the basic thing you have to mention. Here is the pursuit of crime. Here is the property purchase. And here is the material in my hand. And if we will not attach the property, he will run away or he will conceal the pursuit of crime. So these are the basic thing. Otherwise, suppose cut and paste procedure is adopted, the court will notice, because every order, I tell you, because from my experience from the High Court, every order passed by any authority, whether CBI, ED, Income Tax Office, it has to be read by more than 20 people, 30 people, judicial officer. First, basically, it will adjudicating authority will examine it. Then basically, appellant tribunal will examine it. Then High Court single bench will examine. Division bench will examine. Then the Supreme Court will examine. Then all the counsel will read the order. Wherever the lacuna is there, they will pinpoint. One cannot say whatever I have to do, I will do, and I will just get away. That is not the way at all. And you must have seen recent 2 orders passed by the Supreme Court where the bail is granted, and they have mentioned about the cut and paste chapter, that how the confusion has occurred due to the oversight. I know there is basically oversight is always there. If authority, I can commit so many mistakes, I can do some discrepancies thing. But the point here is, it is a stringent law. One should be very careful. Officer has to see each and everything. The effect of one case cannot be repeated in another case, because it has been noticed that comma by comma, the reason to believe have been repeated. It should not be done. Particularly in this type of matter, because it is a very serious matter. You are dealing with the accused party. You are dealing with the parties who have looted the government. You are dealing with the parties who is the offender of our economy. You are dealing with the party who is involved in drug crime. So one should be very careful. The third thing, basically, I say, fair hearing should be there. I say no doubt that under the Benami Act, under the PML Act, there is a procedure for hearing. But suppose you just basically say everything should be decided within 180 days, and there are about thousands of cases and the hearing officer has no time, the perfect thing will not come. Perfect order will not come. He will just hear, because I have been noticing that very short time is given. Even at the evening time, they give 5 or 10 minutes, and ultimately the matter is decided, order is reserved, and then basically is take one para here, one para from there, and order is passed. And ultimately, what is the result? If the matter will go to the higher court, they will examine each and everything, and it will be set aside. I don't want that any order passed by the adjudicating authority should be set aside. It should be at the first stage itself, ED as well as the adjudicating authority will see that there all the cases must be successful. Rather, basically, you may register some cases where those are the genuine cases. If you will register the cases of under the Specific Relief Act or dispute between the parties, those are not the subject matter of PMLA. Only basically as per law, which come under the scheme of the act, those should be registered. No doubt, investigation can be done. If any link and nexus is there, that person must be dealt with. But in every case, you can't say that whatever case is coming and you are registering it without seeing that it is a matter of recovery, it is a matter of specific performance agreement is involved. The person, it's a civil dispute which is already time barred. 10 years have already been passed, limitation expires, and people come to you and file the FIR because there is no time, and you registered the case, and ultimately High Court says that the suit is already time barred and 3-year period has already been expired, and FIR and complaint is registered under PMLA after 10 years. How it is possible? So one should be very careful on that, and fair hearing should be there. Fair hearing should be there. Fourthly, I say that the IO as well as the officer in adjudicating authority must know Evidence Act. They must read Court of Civil Procedure, must know all the latest judgment given by the Honorable High Court as well as the Supreme Court. Without that, if somebody will sit and take few paras here or there, that will not be a good order, because order has to go to the Supreme Court. They will examine each and every word of the order. So command should be there. Command should be there for IO as well as the adjudicating authority. Educated person should involve in the serious matters. And although basically adjudicating authority has one or two judicial officer, I think that there must be more than 5 or 6 persons should be there, and judicial officer should be appointed. Preferably district judge or session judge should be given chance, because they know each and everything on finger. So this experience must be exercised in a very careful manner. You know, it is a very serious offense, and on technical reason, if the proceedings are quashed, that will not serve the purpose. Government will lose the money, authority will lose the money, and they should be take care about all the things. Now, regarding mortgage property, that is also a very serious thing that, roughly I can tell you that when I was the chairman, I have noticed that the banks are claiming to recover the amount worth lakhs of crore rupees from the various crook people. You know, they have taken the loan from the bank. And I can also tell you that the security of the said amount is less than 10%, because they had taken the loan under loan mela, you know, and security is hardly any securities there. And at that time, and originally, security is basically security is given to the bank, and at that time the property was not purchased from the proceed of crime. The property was purchased 50 years ago, and the original documents are there. And because the IO, instead of investigating the accused party for remaining authority, because the mortgage property is readily available with the IO, they attach the property of the mortgage property with the bank. Now the banks are coming on appeal. They are saying that these are the mortgage property. When the property were purchased, it was a clean money. When the property was mortgaged, this person was not involved in money laundering. Why we should suffer? We should not suffer. We should sell the property and recover the money, because banks are in very critical condition. I feel that here is the role of IO, or here is the role of ED, that no doubt, I agree with them that they must recover the amount, they must recover the tainted amount, and these basically complaints are registered at the asking of the bank, because the bank gives the notice that give me my money. They are not giving the money. They are resisting the FIR under section 420. On the basis of 420, the ED will register the case under the PMLA. Now, basically, bank is losing the property. One side, the bank is filing the FIR that we should get the money, we should get the property. And here the bank money is stuck. Now, the point is, no doubt, I agree that if the property is purchased from the tainted money, from the proceed of crime, that property should not be released. But why basically bank are in critical condition? Why the bank should suffer? Bank should not suffer. And we have given the judgment, and our judgment was challenged before the High Court also. High Court, by little modification here or there, almost confirmed the order. And me and member, honorable member, has given so many judgment so that the situation of the bank should be more helpful. They should get some money against the money they have already given. So my request is that this issue should also be solved, although I must appreciate the government as well as the ED that they have pointed out this thing before the government, and government has brought the amendment that during the pendency of the proceeding before the special court, an application can be filed that I am the innocent party and this property is not involved in money laundering. It was not purchased from proceed of crime. The property may be released. Earlier, the stand was different. Earlier, the stand was unless the final judgment is passed, property should not be released. Now, after giving the judgment by the appellate tribunal, by us, so this amendment has been brought, and it is always better that property should be released, and the special courts in many cases are releasing the property. Earlier, appellate tribunal was releasing the property. I totally agree with Prabhuji that this is a very, we have to curb the corruption. It is a very serious offense. We have to cure our financial system, and to cure the economy, we must see that the proceed of crime or proceed of drug crime must be dealt with the iron hand. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We are deeply obliged the way you gave the insights. It's a rare occasion that a person who sits on a seat gives the insights which actually are thought-provoking. And once we had Mr. Suresh Prabhu and your good self, I'm just reminded of the famous quote. They say, watch your thoughts, they become your words. Watch your words, they become your actions. Watch your actions, they become your habits. Watch your habits, they become your character. Watch your character, it becomes your destiny.
Thank you.
If we have watched everything in the right perspective, then I'm quite sure the lacunas in the PMLA Act itself will be resolved in the right perspective. Though I'm also reminded of one of the common joke going amongst the doctors. There was not of coronavirus, there's a lot of flu, etc. Then somebody asked the doctor, how is the season? He said, it's a very healthy season. He said that everybody's unwell. He said, unwell is the society, but the season is healthy for the doctor. It's in on a lighter way, nothing doing there because the doctors are true nation warriors as on today. Over
Thank
to Mr. Ashwin Taneja. His insights have always been taken with a stride. Though amongst us, we have Mr. Amit Khemka and Mr. Aaron Dash. They will also have the insights, as I earlier told. They have their own knowledge. Immense knowledge will be shared on this platform. We're all highly obliged, especially the Beyond Law CLC and Punjabi. Over to you, Mr. Taneja.
Thank you.
Thank you, Vikas ji, for organizing this webinar on such a topic which is going to be need of the country in times to come, despite there being a lockdown, despite we passing through corona times. But this subject will have its own operation. And I will mention the reasons for this, that despite this corona period, why there would be need to enforce anti-enforcement, anti-money laundering law very soon, because of some thoughts coming out from the president of FATF, Financial Action Task Force. And this is going to be a global need, not only India's need. I will share all those things. And Honorable Justice Manmohan, we are really privileged, honored, and what should I say? We have no words. We are speechless to be with you, sir. Sir, I think I do not know. Many few people might be aware of this, that you must have heard a lot about Justice Manmohan as a good judge. But I had this privilege of being in his courtroom, and I can say with full conviction that if you really want to learn the quality of a good judge, if suppose some newcomer wants to ask, some new law student wants to ask, sir, how do you define new judge? I would say you not define, just go into the courtroom of Honorable Justice Manmohan, sit there, and whatever qualities you note down, I think you will find most of them are there. And that is the definition. I think there cannot be anything better occasion. Not only that, as a rule in my office, I was enforcing this, that every new joinee will go by rotation, sit in the court of Honorable Justice Manmohan, note down how the justice is being distributed, is being done, how the law is being interpreted with full humility, with full humbleness, but despite that, full firmness. And despite the law being vague at many occasions, how purposive interpretation and how literal interpretation, both are being infused together with a fine blend. I mean, something remarkable. And above all, for which I am really die-hard fan of, sir, I am sorry I am taking your precious time, but I can't resist. He's a wonderful human being. And that is how I define a judge. A judge has to be, first of all, a good human being. Automatically, competence develops, because the competence is given by the lawyers. But this fairness, the greatness of being a human being cannot be infused by anyone. That is God gifted. And sir, God has really been very kind to you, sir, immensely.
Thank you.
We are getting that benefit, sir.
Thank you, sir.
And we are really benefited from Honorable Sri Suresh Prabhuji's presence here, because of the reason that whatever we are saying, whatever we are doing, whatever we are talking, it is not going to be confined to merely academic discussion. He gave me this assurance at personal level also, this apart from giving this assurance at public platform, that Mr. Taneja, whatever shortcomings, whatever problems you are facing, whatever disconnect you are finding between the intention of the parliament and the law, way the way it is being implemented, please bring it to our notice before the G20 summit starts. We will try to see that these are noted properly and law is amended or law is overhauled or new law is implemented, as Honorable Justice Manmohan has mentioned. Because of one reason, apart from various other reasons, now India is not following other countries. In lawmaking, I have also witnessed personally that I am also a member of International Association of Tax Judges, and we this association conducts its conferences at many parts of the world. That now other countries are following India in terms of lawmaking. It is a different thing that when anti-money laundering law was passed in India in 1998, when first bill was brought out, it was in pursuance to the resolution passed at United Nations. But now India, other countries are looking to India that to see that how we are dealing with anti-money laundering law here in India, because India is a land of variety, huge problems. Whatever India brings out, if India can control those problems, any other country can easily do that. So, I mean, everybody is having, you know, looking towards it. So there are great expectations from G20 summit. So in the backdrop of that, I will make my deliberations. I have noted down some of the fundamental issues which have been aptly raised by Suresh Prabhuji and also by Honorable Justice Manmohan. And these are the real burning issues. And also add on something more, which as a practitioner, I have seen the pain of the people, how they suffer sometimes helplessly. I have also seen the helplessness of the enforcement agency, how some unscrupulous people trouble this agency, that is Enforcement Directorate. So I have tried to harmonize that situation of both. I'll put before you my experiences, my observations. But I am before that, I am really thankful to all of you, my professional brothers and sisters, for sparing your valuable time and for making this session a wonderful session by your keen participation. I'm thankful to Amit Khemkaji, who is now my partner in RRA Legal, but also my guru in terms of legal jurisprudence, particularly criminal jurisprudence. And Anil Agarwalji, I just saw him, good expert in PMLA, Honorable Shri R.N. Dash, and all of them. I'm sorry, I cannot take the names of dignitaries sitting off the dais. So, firstly, what is this money laundering? This first question comes to our mind, money laundering. I will be beginning with the fundamentals so that those who are having first brush with the subject are comfortable in this tour which I am going to take with regard to anti-money laundering law in our country, which is contained in Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002. So friends, first of all, what is money laundering? Because we confuse it sometimes with the conversion of black money into white. Is it that only, or it is something more or something different? Friends, it is different, because converting black to white, it is tax evasion. And tax evasion is taken care of by income tax law. So what is money laundering precisely? That is what we have to understand. And how and why its need arose in our country. That is also for us to understand, because this is very essential for, the success of an economy, to stop the leakages in an economy. It is very, very essential to bring out and implement a very robust anti-money laundering law. That has been experience of many countries, and India followed that mandate, and now India is taking a leading position, as I mentioned. So, Vikasji, I will be sharing my screen. So, if you could kindly enable share.
Yes, we are doing that.
And I will request my professional brothers and sisters not to do annotations. Do not draw any lines on the PPT. It will trouble others. And though I will also do my
Mr. Taneja, you are well versed. You can stop the annotation at your own end.
Okay, sir. I'll do that. Cannot, sir. Abhi disabled RSR sir. Share screen.
I'll just. Rohindaban Mukherjee, kindly disable your screen sharing. We all know that we are on the Zoom. We are quite grateful that you are sharing that part. But could you just disable yourself from that part? Riddhiman Mukherjee, it's a humble request. Sir, meanwhile, you can do that. If Riddhiman Mukherjee is not agreeing, then we have no other option but to remove him. Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Yes. Now it's able. Yes. Now we can see.
So my PPTs are visible, I believe.
Yes.
Okay. And I am audible?
Perfect.
Okay. So I will be dealing with certain practical aspects of the law dealing with the money laundering. First of all, as I shared with you, what is money laundering? Before that, how this law came to our country? In fact, it was felt by many countries worldwide that, financial system, any money laundering done is not only detrimental for the financial system of the country, but also to its integrity and sovereignty. These are the words which were used in the UN Council also. So therefore, a financial action task force was constituted under the aegis of the United Nations. And thereafter, certain resolutions were passed that those who wants to be member of United Nations and really wants to take the benefit of all those, then they have to bring out domestically legislation to curb the menace of money laundering. And that is how, in pursuance to that, first of all, in 1998, Anti-Money Laundering Bill was presented, and which took the shape of Prevention of Money Laundering Act in 2002, which was effective from 2005 only for the first time, 1st July 2005. So what is exactly money laundering? Before that, as I was sharing with you, that the connect of the enforcement directorate or the law of dealing with the money laundering is going to be very, very wide. I mean, you cannot even imagine even those areas where you could not have imagined that, oh, it could be a subject matter of money laundering law or enforcement directorate. I will show certain examples where you will be really amused to notice that, but it is a fact. So therefore, I say all advocates, chartered accountants, may not be willing to engage in this practice, but they should have some basic awareness about this law. Now, these chimpanzees were attached by Enforcement Directorate. You must have heard this news in Times of India. And I was also like you, surprised. How? Chimpanzees and Enforcement Directorate, how it happened? When I studied, I found that as Honorable Justice Manmohan very aptly said, that pursuits of crime can be attached. And pursuits of crime is something which is derived out of commission of scheduled offense. So there is a great, very exhaustive list of scheduled offenses. So one of the list, one of the items there is, violation of Wildlife Protection Act. So a person did violation of Wildlife Protection Act while taking hold of these chimpanzees in his custody. He made some forged certificate also and did violation of that act. So by doing the violation, he committed a scheduled offense. And that is how he got in custody of these, chimpanzees. And that is how it becomes a pursuits of crime. And under Section 5 of PMLA, pursuits of crime can be attached. So that is how ED attached chimpanzees. And fortunately, they were handed over to the zoo authorities for the safe upkeep. And that is how it happened, you see. And you must have said that Modi's Benami law has companies running for cover. So on the other one hand, we have anti-money laundering law already. Then recently, new Benami law was introduced. So if we make fusion of the two, I would say now the situation has come that now the cost of non-compliance is that much higher. Earlier, the cost of compliance was higher, non-compliance was lower. Now the cost of non-compliance has become too much high. So we must, as a professional, as a citizen of this country, align or realign our life, the way we used to think, the way we used to talk, the way we used to behave, the way we used to live, the way we used to do our business. We must align or realign, because the spectrum is so wide and there is going to be strong interplay between various agencies. So on the one hand, there is going to be practically coordinated action on the part of many agencies, like you see multi-agency scrutiny is going to take place, wherein ED, Enforcement Directorate, that is Income Tax Department, Benami Prohibition Unit, SFIO, CBI, they all will work in tandem by using the data analytics techniques. So therefore, on the one hand, practically there has to be interplay between the agencies, and legal scenario is such that the way laws have been drafted are such that they are going to have strong interplay with each other. So in the last of our last session, we discussed various concepts of interplay, that how Benami law will have going to have interplay with anti-money laundering law, income tax law. Similarly, this anti-money laundering law is also going to have strong interplay between the other laws. So therefore, knowledge of basic awareness of all these laws is essential. Even if a person may be doing practice in one area only, while doing transaction, a person, a business entity, an entrepreneur, whosoever may be, has to examine that his transaction is legal, perfectly legal from all angles, not only tax angle, from anti-money laundering law angle, PMLA, that is, from Benami law angle, that is PBPT, from FEMA angle, and from Companies Act angle, and few more. Then offense of money laundering, coming back to that. So in common parlance, the way we understand money laundering is, it is not conversion of black to white only, because that will fall in mere tax evasion, and that is not we understand from the task, from the term money laundering. So what is more therein than hidden? And the more therein is that there has to be, first of all, an offense. Offense which is criminal, and doing any criminal act, and which is recognized as an offense under this law. And from commission of that offense, some proceeds are earned. And those proceeds which are earned from commission of offense are portrayed to be some proceeds as if they were not earned from commission of an offense. Meaning by some illegal proceeds are earned from illegal activities, and those are portrayed to be clean money, as if they are not from crime, but some other legitimate activity. So in other words, legitimatizing the proceeds is money laundering. So as shown in this graph, there has to be, first of all, illegal dirty money earned from any illegal activity. It is converted, and then it becomes legitimate or white money. That is in common parlance. There should be some dispute on legal understanding, which we'll definitely discuss, which was touched upon by Honorable Justice Manmohan keeping in view the recent amendment in Section 3. We will definitely discuss that about also. So these were the activities which many people have been engaged in, this anti-money laundering activities. Some of which is now quite popular is obtaining loan through fraudulent means from the bankers. All these notorious cases which you are hearing, Nirav Modi, Vijay Mallya, Yes Bank, so forth, Sterling Biotech, so forth and so on, these are nothing but obtaining fraud loans from fraudulent means. That is the allegation. And that is how PMLA comes into the picture. How? I will definitely put before you, because some of the issues which were raised, I have noted down. Firstly, the issue was raised by Shri Suresh Prabhu with regard to BEPS, that is Base Erosion and Profit Sharing by various MNCs. And then loss in Honorable Justice Manmohan raised a very, very prominent issue, that is the loss being caused to the bankers because of default from the borrowers, and the loss getting aggravated by on account of their approaching to the ED. It should have benefited them, but they are rather or incurring more losses by approaching ED for the corrective action. Then some of the viewers have raised some queries in chat box with regard to how the bank defaults come into PMLA regime and how to distinguish between POC and non-POC, that is pursuits of crime and non-pursuits of crime. And they want me also to discuss Nikesh Tarachand judgment of Honorable Supreme Court. I will be covering all of them, friends. Then first of all, what is the legislation that is covering PMLA in our country? As you all know, it is anti-money laundering is governed by Prevention of Money Laundering Act 2002, enacted in 2002, but made effective from 2005. And agency, the enforcement agency is Enforcement Directorate, and executive functions under the Act like search, seizure, provisional attachment, arrest, they have got the power of arrest also, unlike Income Tax Department. And that is what makes this law quite harsh, that because of arrest, because of fear of arrest. And of course, attachment. So two things. Firstly, attachment power is not there in the Income Tax Department as much they have here in the Enforcement Directorate, and then arrest also. Binami Prohibition Unit have power of attachment, but they do not have power of arrest. Then of course, prosecution, criminal prosecution powers, immense powers have been granted to ED to enforce this law properly. Then other agency which helps the enforcement agency or the people affected by the action of the enforcement agencies is adjudicating authority. You must have heard this name, adjudicating authority. In fact, this word adjudicating has been used differently under different legislation. In FEMA authorities, in FEMA law, it has been used in different context. Here in PMLA, it has been used in the context whereby it is a quasi-judicial authority established under the Act, which exclusively adjudicates matters connected with the incidental to the attachment and retention of the property records. The authority has also the power to lay down its own procedure. So friends, this authority is not dealing with the criminal criminal trial part associated with this law, but only the civil part, that is the property attachment part. Though it may be connected in one way or the other with the criminal part, directly or indirectly, but it is dealing only with the attachment of the properties and connected matter there too. For example, retention of records, retention of properties, attachment of properties, etc. Then the adjudicating authority has been clothed with the powers of civil court regarding the issuance of summon, production of documents and evidence. Unfortunately, I have not found adjudicating authority sufficiently equipped with the requisite infrastructure to use this power in appropriate manner. So it is not with due respect, I am saying, properly functioning like a civil court, even while the actions are going to be very, very significant actions, even if they confront the attachment or release the attachment. But the way civil courts are functioning, the way they record the witnesses, take the evidence, the same procedure is not being followed in majority of the cases. And it consists of chairman and two other members. The chairman and members are persons having expertise in the field of law, administration, finance, and account. The PMLA law requires that one person should have, you know, expertise in law, and other members should have expertise in administration or finance and accounting. So the idea was they can infuse the knowledge. But unfortunately, the cases are heard singly in single member constitution. So since it is heard in single member constitution, fusion is not taking place. So since fusion is not taking place, the wholesome justice, the holistic justice is not likely to be seen in the orders passed by the adjudicating authority because of the basic flaw, the way structuring has been done. Then next is appellate tribunal. That is where we start getting the relief, because it is the first forum only where the application of mind is done. I should not be noted of saying that justice is the application of mind is not done at all down below this authority. But what I'm trying to say is, because other authorities are functioning like executive authorities, they are not in a position to the way the pattern of working of in our country has become. The judicious application starts only before tribunal, be it income tax law, be it PMLA, be it Benami law only. There may be flaw in working, there may be certain constraints, there may be certain reasons behind it, but the fact today is that the judicial application of mines starts only before the tribunal. And particularly when this august institution is headed by a judge or a former judge from a high court, then of course all the fundamentals of the jurisprudence, the basic thread of the constitution is upheld, is respected, is maintained, and that is how the law is implemented to the in a most fair manner to the extent possible in a given circumstance. So it has been established under Section 25 of PMLA. Though one problem is also there, which I must surely tell. I salute to Honorable Justice Manmohan that despite this problem, things were done to the best possible manner. And the problem is that this tribunal is also overburdened with ample work, because this tribunal has today the jurisdiction of not only PMLA, it has the jurisdiction of dealing with NDPC, NDPS, narcotics cases, FEMA cases, UFIPOSA, SAFEMA, and then the listed latest edition is Benami law, which is bringing out huge work and no infrastructure. So there were two or three members at any given point of time and the jurisdiction is pan India, one bench only. So despite that, the judgments which have been passed under PMLA and Benami law, I would say par excellence. What a recent judgment, how the law has been analyzed despite these subjects being complex subjects. You can read any judgment on PMLA side or on Benami law. All those are, most of them are available on the PMLA website. You can see judgments in Benami law, for example. I remember very good judgment passed by the Honorable Tribunal, wherein they have laid down the concept of burden of proof, which otherwise would have been, thrashed out or decided maybe in 5 years down the line. But so the job of the High Court has been made much, much easier, because the law declared by the Supreme Court has been analyzed. So on that platform, Honorable High Courts can easily now decipher the law, reinforce the law in whatever manner High Courts deem it appropriate. So once a person is aggrieved, maybe ED or any noticee or person, any accused person whose property has been attached, or any interested party who's aggrieved with the order of the addressing authority, he can approach the appellate tribunal by filing of appeal within 45 days. Then a special court. Then, sir, the other important ingredient or the forum in this entire structure is, which is very, very important forum, is special court, that is court of session. This is the designated court of sessions established under the act for conducting the trial for offense of money laundering. The special court, while trying the offense of money laundering, shall be governed by the procedure laid down in the criminal procedure code for conducting the trial before the court of session. So on the one hand, attachment proceedings are taken care by the adjudicating authority, and the criminal jurisprudence, that part, criminal trial part, is taken by the special court. So both the proceedings run parallel, side by side. On the one hand, prosecution part, on the other hand, attachment of the property part. Then this is, I have created for the easy understanding, web of actions. Why this PMLA law has become so harsh today? Because many arrows are thrown suddenly, shot, many arrows. With one complaint only, if a person is accused to be indulged in the found indulged in the offense of money laundering, that so many actions which you see, that is why I have named this slide as web of actions which are initiated on the part of ED. So firstly, investigation or search by, say, any investigation agencies, which could be income tax department, police, CBI, NCB, forest department, any action is taken by on the part of that department. So then investigation starts by the enforcement directorate. Suppose the complaint is given to the investigation department that this person may be found indulged in the offense of money laundering. And on the other hand, that investigation agency files complaint for the scheduled offense, because if the agency find, this investigation agency find that any scheduled offense has been committed, so its complaint is filed to scheduled offense, charge sheet may be filed in the jurisdictional court. And then when ED comes into picture, you can see on the right side of the slide, when ED comes into picture, then it can also file complaint to the court, that is special court, for that person under Section 45, that person is alleged to be found involved in the offense of money laundering. And then simultaneously, it can make provisional attachment of the property, which is the proceeds of crime. and then it can go, then the matter goes to the addressing authority thereafter, and then its confirmation or release takes place. And on the other hand, the special court starts the trial of the scheduled offense, and then also for the offense of the money laundering. And then that is how the three proceedings run parallel, I mean, to each other, and a web of actions is created. And we will definitely learn more about them bit by bit in coming slides. So before that, important things which bother us, because one of the issues which were raised by, sir, what is money laundering, and sir, what is proceeds of crime? First of all, we have understood so far in common parlance that what is money laundering, but how law defines it, that also let's understand. Because of the specific reason that there has been some amendment in 2019, which is shaking the very concept, some people are saying that, which is shaking the very concept of offense of money laundering. I will discuss what is that shaking part. But before that, let us read the original definition of money laundering as is given section 3. And it says that whosoever directly or indirectly attempts to indulge or knowingly assists or knowingly is a party or is actually involved in any process or activity connected with the proceeds of crime, including its concealment, possession, acquisition, or use, and this word "and" is in red, and I will give the reason for that, and projecting or claiming as untainted property, shall be guilty of offense of money laundering. So friends, if you kindly notice, so first thing is that a person indulging in any criminal activity, and then second part is he should earn some proceeds of crime from there, and then the third part is, which is connected with the word "and," he should project or claim this as untainted property. So he is doing some offense, then he is earning some proceeds, and he is projecting it as untainted property. And that is a cardinal principle, or the entire superstructure on the basis of which the entire law of money laundering is based, that he should project it as untainted property. But some explanation has been added, and the explanation says a person shall be guilty of offense of money laundering, so and so, it is repetition. And then thereafter it says concealment or possession or acquisition or use or projecting as untainted property or claiming as untainted property in any manner whatsoever. So if you kindly notice very carefully, this word projecting precedes with the word or and it succeeds with the word or. So before that, after that, or is there. Whereas in the definition, if you kindly see, there was the word "and." So now the substantive part of the definition is different from the explanation part. Apparently, you can see the disconnect. And explanation, I mean, it is saying for the removal of doubts. For the removal of doubt means the law should be something like that only. There should not be some ambiguity. But there is no ambiguity. It is word "and" is there. So how an explanation can change the substantive part? I mean, I cannot say anything. The origin, the concept of the law remains same. Its objects have not been altered. So therefore, I think if this law should find the constitutional sustainability, the constitutionality of this law, then the higher courts have to read this law, it is my belief, in harmony with the objects, in the harmony with the essence and the soul of the substantive law, which is saying projection should be there. Otherwise, what will happen? Suppose a person did some crime, say theft, and the moment he steals a property, the stolen property itself becomes proceeds of crime, and he can also be said to be engaged in the offense of money laundering. So A, he is alleged to be or charged to be found in the offense of theft, and also simultaneously in the offense of money laundering without committing any second offense. So how can a person be with one action be said to be committing two offenses, whereas when the law has created two offenses separately and should be? So there seems to be some disconnect. So leaving it that at this stage, let us cover up other fundamental things.
Ashwini ji, there was a text in the chat box that kindly go slow, but to the contrary, I will say, since the entire this PMLA etc. hinges upon that, few people are who have requested on the WhatsApp कि अगर ये हिंदी में भी थोड़ा सा समझा दें तो इजी हो जाएगा, ये जो दो distinctions बताई हैं।
बहुत अच्छी बात है सर, जैसा आप कहें मैं वैसा कर दूंगा, लेकिन जहां तक स्पीड की बात है, देखो कुछ छोड़ना पड़ेगा, और स्लाइड्स आपके सामने है ही, तो अगर आप थोड़ा सा बियर करेंगे, मैं स्लो तो हो सकता हूँ, थोड़ा सा बियर करेंगे तो शायद
स्लो हो जाएंगे। अच्छा लगता है रोहित शर्मा छक्के मारता रहे, पर साथ साथ समझ भी आता जाए, छक्के तो समझ आ जाते हैं, ये कई बार नहीं बात समझ आते।
ठीक है सर, ठीक है, I'll make the corrections to the extent necessary. Yes. But thank you. It shows one thing that you are lending your ears to me. I am really motivated. So, friends, अभी तक जो मैंने आपको बताया, देखिए जो money laundering की definition है, उसमें एक बड़ा disconnect आ गया है. And I don't know why this disconnect was necessary. And this will create havoc. बहुत problems हो जाएंगी इससे, क्योंकि high courts को read down करना पड़ेगा इसको, otherwise या फिर amendment की जरूरत होगी. द बेसिक कॉन्सेप्ट है कि उसमें मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग में कन्वर्जन और पोर्ट्रेइंग फ्रॉम टेंटेड टू अनटेंटेड इज एन एसेंशियल इंग्रेडिएंट। जब तक ये नहीं होगा, ऑफेंस ऑफ मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग नहीं माना जाना चाहिए। लेट्स सी हाउ द हायर कोर्ट्स डिसाइड्स और हाउ एनी सूटेबल अमेंडमेंट्स आर ब्रॉट आउट। लेट्स सी, बिकॉज दिस इज अ वेरी रिसेंट अमेंडमेंट, इट हैज बीन ब्रॉट आउट विद इफेक्ट फ्रॉम 1 August 2019। चलिए अब हम चलते हैं प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम। तो पहला ऑफेंस ऑफ मनी लॉन्ड्रिंग सबसे इंपॉर्टेंट जो बर्निंग इशू रहता है पूरे इसमें, और दूसरा द एंटायर यू नो द इशू द सब्जेक्ट रिवॉल्व्स अराउंड व्हाट इज प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम। दो जस्टिस मनमोहन हैज वेरी वेल समड अप एंड बट इसको मैं लीगल डाइसेक्शन करके भी अपनी बात रखूंगा आपके सामने कि जो मैं कहने जा रहा हूं उसके पीछे क्या कारण है, उसके पीछे मैं एविडेंस दूंगा आपको कि किस तरह से गलत समझा गया है इसको कॉन्सेप्ट को, और लॉ में ऐसी कोई गलती की गुंजाइश नहीं है, लॉ बिल्कुल क्लियर है, उसकी छोटी सी वेगनेस की वजह से शायद जो कि पर्पस ऑफ इंटरप्रिटेशन के अगेंस्ट है, शायद गलत लॉ को इंटरप्रेट कर लिया है। लेकिन अब टू अवर रेस्क्यू जजमेंट ऑफ ऑनरेबल पंजाब हरियाणा हाईकोर्ट हैज कम विच हैज रियली एनालाइज दिस सेक्शन एट अ ग्रेट लेंथ विच वॉज ऑलरेडी एनालाइज बाई ऑनरेबल जस्टिस मनमोहन एंड नाउ ब्यूटिफुली एनालाइज इन ए प्रॉपर मैनर बाई ऑनरेबल हाईकोर्ट ऑल्सो। वी वेन एवर वी यूज टू आर्ग्यू बिफोर ऑनरेबल जस्टिस मनमोहन वी यूज टू गेट यू नो वेरी पेशेंट हियरिंग एंड ऑन द सिमिलर फैशन दोज यू नो आर्ग्यूमेंट्स हैव रीच्ड बिफोर द हाईकोर्ट एंड आई विल डिस्कस बिफोर यू ऑल ऑफ दैट। प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम है क्या सर, ये समझते हैं। डेफिनेशन 2(1)(u) इट सेज प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम मीन्स एनी प्रॉपर्टी डिराइव्ड और ऑब्टेन्ड डायरेक्टली और इनडायरेक्टली बाई एनी पर्सन as a result of criminal activity relating to a scheduled offense or the value of any such property or where such property is taken or held outside the country then the property equivalent in value held within the country। so friends aapne dekha ki isme do baatein likhi hain, do situation create kiye hain। pehli situation ki jab property india mein rehti hai aur dusri situation jab property india se bahar chali jati hai। अब क्वेश्चन ये उठता है कि प्रॉपर्टी का मतलब क्या है, जो हमने प्रोसीड जो जो किसी पर्सन ने क्राइम करके अर्न की हो वही, या उसकी अगर वो नहीं मिलती तो उसके अलावा कोई और प्रॉपर्टी भी उसकी प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम में आएगी, क्योंकि वैल्यू ऑफ एनी सच प्रॉपर्टी का क्या मतलब है और नीचे इक्विवेलेंट इन द वैल्यू का क्या मतलब है। मैं एग्जाम्पल से अपनी बात रखता हूं। सपोज ए पर्सन डिड थेफ्ट एंड ही स्टोल सम से कैश और रुपीज 50 lakhs और उस 50 lakh का उन्होंने गोल्ड खरीदा, उस गोल्ड को उन्होंने बेचा, उससे उसको बैंक में जमा किया, उस बैंक से उन्होंने पेमेंट करके शेयर्स खरीदे, उस शेयर्स को फिर बेचा, अब वो 50 लाख के शेयर 75 लाख में बिके, उस शेयर्स को बेच के उन्होंने प्लॉट खरीदा, प्लॉट में 75 लाख ये डाले और 25 लाख और डाले तो 1 crore रुपए के हो गए वो प्लॉट, प्लॉट 1 crore का हो गया, उस प्लॉट की वैल्यू आज 1.5 crore रुपीज हो जाती है। तो अब इनमें से क्या क्या प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम में आ जाएगा अगर हम इसको लें प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम की डेफिनेशन में, तो जो मेरी अंडरस्टैंडिंग है जिसके मैं आपको सब्सटेंशिएट करूंगा, इनमें से कोई भी चीज प्रोसीड्स ऑफ क्राइम में आ जाएगी, यानी कि आप 50 lakh रुपीज से चलिए कैश भी आ जाएगा अगर कैश उनके हाथ में आता है, इफ द कैश इज फाउंड, शेयर्स भी आ जाएंगे इफ कैश शेयर्स इज फाउंड, बैंक बैलेंस भी आ जाएगा, गोल्ड भी आ जाएगा, वो प्लॉट भी आ जाएगा 75 lakh का, और 75 lakh का अगर 1 crore का हो गया तो वो भी आ जाएगा, बट जो 50 lakh रुपीज एड किए थे वो नहीं आएंगे। वैल्यू का मतलब वो वैल्यू है जो बढ़कर वैल्यू हो गई है उसकी, नॉट दैट विच हैज बीन इन्फ्यूज्ड लेटर ऑन। अब दूसरा क्वेश्चन ये उठता है कि क्या कोई और प्रॉपर्टी से सम अदर रेजिडेंशियल हाउस विच वॉज गिफ्टेड टू दैट पर्सन बाय हिज ग्रैंडफादर दैट कैन बी कवर्ड। सपोज दिस 50 lakh रुपीज थेफ्ट अमाउंट स्टोलन अमाउंट, सपोज ही गोज इन द कैसीनो एंड लूजेस दिस मनी इन कैसीनो, सो कैन दिस रुपी नाउ इफ द एनफोर्समेंट एजेंसी कम्स इन टू एक्शन that stolen money is not found, whether pursuits of crime would be any other property found, say some other plot of land or some other shares which were gifted or obtained from some other sources unconnected with this, can that be covered? That is a question before us. According to me, no. And I will make dissection of this. If you kindly see, two situations have been created. One situation is where value of any such property, where if the property is India. And later on amendment was made and it was said if the property is taken outside India, then equivalent in value held within the country or abroad. Now this expression equivalent in value has been differently used. So iska matlab equivalent in value pehle nahi tha. Agar pehle bhi hota to is naye amendment ko dalne ki zarurat nahi thi. Kyunki amendment dala aur usme equivalent word lekar aaye. Pehle equivalent word nahi tha and whenever the legislature uses the word, it uses the word for a particular purpose. There is a objective behind it. It is not objectiveless. It is not aimless. So since legislature has done it for this purpose, therefore it should be seen like that only. I will show with the help of when we will proceed further, I will show with the help of a slide how two situations have been created. But before that, let us read this amendment which has been made in section 1A 2019. For the removal of doubt, it is hereby clarified that pursuits of crime include property not only derived or obtained from the scheduled offense, but also any property which may directly or indirectly be derived or obtained as a result of any criminal activity related to any scheduled offense. Now what does it include? Suppose crime, उस crime के साथ साथ कोई subsidiary crime किया गया है जो कि scheduled offence में नहीं आता, right? तो उसके जो proceeds हैं वो भी proceeds of crime मानी जाएंगी अगर कोई connected crime हुआ है. So this is to that extent only. Scheduled offence से क्या मतलब है? Scheduled offence से मतलब है any offence which is mentioned in part A, part B of the schedule of PMLA, जिसमें बहुत सारे offences का जिक्र है, जैसे कि theft, जैसे कि cheating, जैसे कि forgery, जैसे कि प्रिवेंशन ऑफ करप्शन एक्ट, जैसे कि ड्रग पेडलिंग, टेररिज्म एंड सो फोर्थ एंड सो ऑन मेनी. एंड बिलीव मी देयर आर सर्टेन अदर लेजिस्लेशंस आल्सो व्हिच हैव बीन मेंशनड देयर व्हिच यू कैन नॉट इमेजिन ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ कॉमन सेंस लाइक पोल्यूशन कंट्रोल वायलेशन ऑफ एनी वाटर पोल्यूशन कंट्रोल एक्ट, एयर पोल्यूशन कंट्रोल एक्ट, वाइल्ड लाइफ प्रोटेक्शन एक्ट एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा सो फोर्थ एंड सो ऑन सेक्शन 120B सेक्शन 420 ऑफ IPC एटसेट्रा. So this I have already explained that there should be three stages of this. I can skip. Then how commencement of proceedings are done under PMLA? Firstly, inquiry and investigation takes place, as you see, and how inquiry can be done. The section 50 gives the power to PM under section 50 of PMLA gives power to the enforcement directorate to issue summons to the persons for recording their statements and for production of any document. Any statement recorded under section 50 of the Evidence Act is admissible evidence in the court or not admissible. This is a big question, but so far the judgments are saying they are admissible. They cannot be said to be inadmissible because of the restrictions given under Article 20 bracket 3 of Constitution of India on the same parameters as the statements recorded under section 161 of CRPC. So here it is said by the many courts that it is admissible, but the evidentiary value of such statement remains a big question. If the statements are recorded under pressure, not in the fair environment, not with the volition, free will, then of course the evidentiary value remains under the cloud of doubts. Then the ED has the power of search, seizure, survey under section 16 and 17 and 18 of PMLA, and power of arrest, of course, if the requisite conditions prevail. Then it can file original application to the adjudicating authority. Suppose under during the course of survey and search, it has retained some documents, impounded some documents, then for the retention of the same, it can move to the adjudicating authority and retain the same. Then after making attachment under section 5, it can file original complaint under section 5 bracket 5 of PMLA. Then proceedings for criminal prosecution. So simultaneously, as I said, that parallel proceedings can be initiated. Firstly, an ECIR is filed and then a prosecution complaint can also be filed under section 45 of PMLA before the special court for trying the criminal trial for prosecuting the person under section 45 of PMLA. Then this I am skipping for the time being, that is original application. This original complaint, as I said, that it is the ED has the power under section 5(1) to make order for provisional attachment of such pursuits of crime, and such attachment is valid for period of 180 days. So 180 days tak valid rahega, usse pehle hi ED adjudicating authority mein jana hai aur adjudicating authority ko isko confirm karna hai प्रोविजनल अटैचमेंट ऑर्डर को या रिलीज करना है। अगर कंफर्म नहीं किया तो रिलीज माना जाएगा, और कंफर्म कर दिया तो जैसा मैंने कहा कि इसको एपीलेट ट्रिब्यूनल में इसकी अपील डाली जा सकती है। देन दिस आई एम स्किपिंग फॉर द टाइम बीइंग। देन लेट मी टेक अप दैट दैट पार्ट वेयर आई से दैट देयर इज सम डिफरेंस हाउ द लॉ टेक्स प्लेस यू नो इन प्रैक्टिस एंड द लॉ हाउ इट इज कंटेंड इन द बुक्स। सो in that firstly I will share with you this section 72A has been inserted, which says inter-ministerial coordination committee. The central government has constituted actually inter-departmental inter-agency coordination for the following purposes, namely operational cooperation between the government, law enforcement agencies, and etc, which you can see on the slide. And this is reinforcing the earlier thought which I was giving, that there is going to be strong interplay in practically also and legally speaking also between various legislations. Okay. Then as now coming back to that dissection which I wanted to make between 2-1-U, that how proceeds of crime would mean only that very proceed only. So I have divided this section into two parts as the section is, that is first situation and second situation. First situation is where the property is held in India, and second situation is where the property is taken or held outside India. So first situation, friends, it says proceeds of crime means any property derived or obtained directly, indirectly by any person as a result of criminal activity relating to the scheduled offense or value of any such property. And kindly see in second situation, it says the property equivalent in value. So thus from the above, it is clear from the bare reading that the legislature has made distinction while using two expressions differently in two different situations. And friends, there is one more reason. The second reason is ultimately property, the purpose of attachment is so that the property remains available before the special court if the special court wants to order for its confiscation. And property will be confiscated only when the special court finds that it was involved in the offense of money laundering. We can read section 8. So since only that property is to be attached which was involved in the offense of money laundering, what is the point or fun in attaching that property which is not involved in the offense of money laundering? What will happen to that? Special court is going to give no order for any such property. So, I mean, that property will remain in vacuum. The person who is owning that property will be unnecessarily harassed. So that is why for this reason also, probably my view is that any such property cannot be attached. And to our rescue, recently this judgment of Honorable Punjab and Haryana High Court in the name of Seema Garg, very recent judgment, bahut hi naya naya judgment aaya 6 March 2020 ka, in appeal number 131 se lekar 3 tak of 2019, in which they have, the Honorable Lordships have analyzed this issue in that very context which I have just put before you, and they said no other property can be attached. It's worth reading judgment, available on the site of the Honorable High Court, very recent judgment. And they have also followed the judgment of Honorable Andhra Pradesh High Court in the case of Satyam Computers, and also followed the judgment of Delhi High Court in the case of Abdullah Ali Balsharaf, but not followed the judgment of Honorable Delhi High Court in the case of Axis Bank. So this judgment mentioned in red color is the only judgment contrary to the view which I have placed, but other judgments are taking the view that as the law says clearly that pursuits of crime means that property which has the trace of pursuits of crime. इसको मैं हिंदी में कुछ सिंपल लैंग्वेज में इस तरह से कुछ कहने की कोशिश करता हूँ कि सपोज एक चीटी को आपने इंक में डिप किया, इंक में डिप करके आपने उसे छोड़ दिया, तो जहां जहां वो चीटी जाएगी वो अपना जो ट्रेल छोड़ेगी, तो pursuits of crime का भी वही मतलब है। जहां जहां वो pursuits of crime जाएगी उसके genesis, उसका ट्रेस ओरिजिनल क्राइम की एक्टिविटी से होना चाहिए, only then it will be pursuits of crime, otherwise not. So section 3 already I have covered कि इसमें अब जो वर्ड और है इसका बड़ा एक अच्छा एक नया कंट्रोवर्शियल डिबेट शुरू होने वाला है. लेट्स सी हाउ द थिंग्स हैपन. अनदर इंपॉर्टेंट इश्यू विच आई वॉन्ट टू पुट बिफोर यू इज सेक्शन 24. आपने सुना होगा अक्सर ये कहा जाता है कि साहब ये लॉ इसलिए हार्श है क्योंकि इसमें रिवर्स बर्डन है. रिवर्स बर्डन का मतलब क्या हुआ कि साहब हमारा कॉन्स्टिट्यूशनल का फ्रेमवर्क ये है कि ए पर्सन इज innocent unless he is proved guilty, and the burden to prove that he is guilty is upon the person who is alleging him to be guilty, that is the prosecution. So unless prosecution proves, the person will remain as innocent only. But it is said that this concept has been reversed under PMLA. Is it right or it is wrong? I would say it is partly right, but not wholly right. How? Because the burden is burden has been shifted partly only. Burden has not been shifted fully. How? I will share with you. And we have the benefit of presence of legal inimilies before us today. And I may be corrected or modified to the extent you find it necessary, because these are really controversial issues and a lot of deliberations are required on this. It says, Section 24 says, in any proceeding related to pursuits of crime under this Act, in case of a person charged with the offense of money laundering, the authority or the court shall, unless the contrary is proved, presume that the proceeds of crime are involved in money laundering. So kindly see, it is beginning with the case with the person charged with the offense of money laundering. So person has to be, first of all, charged. So there has to be filing of complaint and person has to be charged. Filing of complaint under scheduled offense. And then filing of complaint by the enforcement directorate under Section 45. So person should be charged. Then the authority of the court shall, contrary is proved, unless contrary is proved, presume that proceeds of crime are involved. So presumption is being allowed only that the proceeds of crime are involved in money laundering. But how many stages are there for offense of money laundering? Three stages, as I mentioned. What three stages? Stage number one, there has to be crime, commission of offense. And stage number two, generation of proceeds therefrom, from the commission of offense. And third, then converting those proceeds into good money. So the presumption is only for third stage. It is nowhere saying there will be presumption for these first two stages. But unfortunately, the orders, the way orders have been passed in certain cases, at the level of adjudicating authority, the three stages have been presumed. Or the when the attachment is done, and the show cause notices are issued, as if all the three stages are to be proved by the person accused. It is not the case. The law is, the intention of the law, according to my understanding, is not this. So this first two stages is the burden of the enforcement agency. And the third stage is the burden of the accused, person accused. That is how the law in true spirit can be implemented. And that is how the real culprits of this law can be nabbed. Otherwise, the focus will be lost. And as Honorable Justice Manmohan had very rightly mentioned, that there will be, you know, huge heap of cases, some of which only will be relevant, and unnecessarily the energies will be scattered and frittered away, which is not the right approach. Then, sir, this PPT I'll be sharing, so you need not note down. Then, sir, Section 5 of PMLA gives immense powers to the enforcement directory to make attachment. But before that, certain conditions are precedent and conditions are reason to believe. Honorable Justice Manmohan has very aptly said, reasons have to be valid in the eyes of law. May it not be lengthy. There is no, you know, no formula prescribed how the reasons should be written. But reasons have to be inherently acceptable to any court of law. And to be inherently acceptable in the court of law, they have to make a connect between the material and the belief. There has to be some cause and effect relationship. So the proof of offense of money laundering may not be available, but the proof of circumstances which are alleging that money laundering has been done, those circumstances proof should be there at the stage of recording of reasons, at least, number one. And number two, in the judgment of Seema Garg, which I mentioned a few minutes before, they have very rightly analyzed the significance of reasons. And they have said reasons will not be valid merely when the words mentioned in the statute are reproduced in the reasons, that the asset is likely to be alienated. No, you have to give something more. Why are you thinking that something which was possessed since last 20 years by a person and in which there is no direct evidence of infusion of proceeds of crime, that is likely to be alienated? How? You have to bring out something more, some tangible evidences. And in what manner the reason should be recorded? That also been held, discussed at great length. And in many cases, this has been made a mechanical exercise. Its sanctity has been lost. I think a due respect should be given to ensure that the law is not misused and real, real culprits are, you know, caught. And then, friends, I will leave it at that stage. And then certain things I am leaving because they are hyper-technical. And let me come back to adjudicating authority. Yes. Now, firstly, while giving the notice by the adjudicating authority to any person accused or whose property has been attached, they have to record reason to believe that any person has committed the offense of money laundering or is in person possession of POC. And only after forming of such reason to believe, the addressing authority can issue show cause notice to the person. But I mean, to my best of knowledge and understanding, in none of the cases, any such reasons either have not been recorded or not conveyed. I do not know what is the truth. So in none of the notices, I could find that. So this again has become a mechanical exercise, maybe because of the overburden upon the authority, maybe because more training is required to understand this complex subject. And maybe person with the sound knowledge of jurisprudence needs to be placed there. Maybe some other reasons are there. So this law should not be implemented in, because this is very harsh law. And whenever harsh medicines are administered, they have to be administered very, very, very carefully. And the medicines to neutralize the effect of the side effect of harsh medicines have to be kept ready. So, I mean, I think a lot of improvements are required at that stage. Then, another very, 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 very painful area is that the moment adjudicating authority confirms the attachment, one of the section of the PMLA says the ED can have constructive possession of the attached property. Possession of the attached property. So that is why judicious application of mind by the adjudicating authority is necessary. Because the moment mechanically order is passed, a person may suffer. I think this provision also needs amendment. Why? Because when the confiscation is to be done by the court, special court, after the final adjudication, after the final order, final conviction, then how can possession be given at this stage? Because giving possession is nothing less than confiscation. The property goes out of the hand of a person, and property may not come back in the right stage, in the right state as it was given. It is very difficult for a government agency to maintain the property as the true owner of the property will maintain. So what is the need? If it is the attachment is ensuring that the property does not go anywhere, the right of possession, as has been rightly prescribed under Benami law, that it comes to the enforcement agency only after the appellate order is passed by the appellate tribunal. And then fresh proceedings are done by the adjudicating authority that whether confiscation should be allowed or not. Similarly, here also same thing should happen. Otherwise, because the ED is overburdened, mechanically properties are attached because of hugeness of work, ample work. And then suddenly adjudicating authority is also overburdened. And then adjudicating authority also passed the order in same fashion because of their time limit of 180 days. And then a person is deprived of his property and he is neither here nor there. Where to knock the doors. High court would say, no, go back to the tribunal. And then tribunal becomes overburdened. Then tribunal would grant status quo. And suppose there is a failure, there is some delay in approaching the tribunal on the part of that person because of the lack of understanding of the law. The person do. So dire need is there to show indulgence by the appropriate authorities and to make corrections in the law. Then there are certain other things, but before that, I will show the interplay of the law. If the money laundering state takes place, there are chances that the Benami law violation has also taken place. The violation of tax evasion has also taken place. Now the next question arises, whether the tax evasion is also one of the scheduled offenses. Surprisingly, tax evasion as such, that is income tax evasion as such, has not been made a scheduled offense. But certain provisions of Black Money Act, violation of Black Money Act, section 50 and 51, of Black Money Act has been made scheduled offense. Certain provisions of violation of Customs Act have been made, but violation of Benami law, I believe, has not been made. And what about properties located outside India? Whether that will also be covered? Yes. India has got territorial nexus with other countries made arrangement. PMLA law empowers them. Section 56 of PML empowers to make arrangement agreements with other countries. So through letter rotegri and other mechanism is there, and vice versa approach has been entered with many countries, and that is how property in other countries, for example, you must have heard there was some recent news in the newspaper recently, some properties of somebody outside India have been attached recently, and in the cases of say Nirav Modi and all that, also wherever properties are located outside India, the ID is making best efforts to attach the properties because of the provisions, specific provisions also given in section 21U, which also says if that cannot be attached, then property equivalent value can be attached here. But that does not mean that property located outside India cannot be attached. If it is proceeds of crime, and it is taken outside India through proper arrangements, through proper channels that can also be attached. Then friends, one case study only I will discuss, and then we can bring into the deliberations, we can have question answer session. This is a, you know, case of a distillery unit. It was established in 2005, and it was found to LS to have done some violation of Water Pollution Control Act. Some complaint was filed by the Pollution Control Board of the city. Nothing happened therein, but matter was picked up by the ED, and ED gave a notice to attachment of its factory. I was also amused, like you are, how Water Pollution Act and attachment of factory? Yes, I will explain how. So the allegation was that this factory discharged extra water into the river. So the capacity was 50 KL, it discharged 75 KL. So 25 KL was extra discharged in the river. That means the plant was not functioning well or whatever the reason. Though it set up a, later on set up that unit, set up a water treatment plant, and therefore nothing, no action, further adverse action was taken by PCB. But in the meantime, ED swung into action. And then ED says, since extra water was discharged into river, that means extra production was done beyond the permitted line. So that means violation of Water Pollution Control Act has been done. So extra production means extra sales, and extra sales means extra profits you earned. And that is the pursuits of crime which you, which the unit invested in the factory building, and that is how the factory is liable to be attached. Fortunately, the factory got status quo from the tribunal for the time being. But this tough time they have passed through. Then in somebody dealt in Bitcoin, and he was alleged to be, committed a scheduled offense, because the Bitcoin later on was made an offense. So he was just one of the investor, but his properties were attached. His FD has been attached because of dealing with the Bitcoin, because, and now ED has also swung into action apart from the proceedings he's facing in the other offenses, that is the scheduled offenses which he is alleged to have committed. Now, additionally, he is facing the offense of money laundering also, and rightly so, if he has done the offense of money laundering. But I wanted to give this case study to show that how the things are connected. So if a person is doing any transaction, he has to vet it from all angles, all possible angles. If a person buys a property, he has to see from this angle also, that lest his property is, you know, acquired from by anybody from the proceeds of crime. So therefore, he has to buy it by making appropriate proceeds, by adequate proceeds, that is sales consideration. So if it is not doing it, so he should be cautious. Then last issue which I will take up is that bank default cases, which somebody was mentioning, that how bank default cases can be roped in. If a person obtains loan from a banker through fraudulent means by forging or siphons of the money, then this is a scheduled offense. Banker can file its complaint before the competent agencies, that is CBI. It becomes a scheduled offense, and then its complaint can be filed to ED. Then suppose ED has filed complaint, suppose banker has filed complaint to ED, ED will swing into action. So the loan amount, suppose the borrower had taken a loan amount of rupees 1000 crore, a big borrower, corporate house. So that 1000 crore which was obtained from the banker in this fashion, that loan taken by that borrower, will be treated as pursuits of crime. Not only that, wherever that trail goes, that 1000 crores have traveled. I mean, many persons may have dealt with that borrower, that corporate. Though, like that, the ant example I gave, wherever it is traveling, going, moving, that entirely will be covered as pursuits of crime, and it is being hit. So firstly, under that case, the spectrum will be too wide. You can pick up the Yes Bank's case. You can see any such case where the things have happened like that. Then, not only that, the real problem is, which Honorable Justice Manmohan mentioned before us, the purpose of the banker was to curtail its loss, to recover some money out of that. Now, the banker has filed complaint. Now, by the time matter reaches before the tribunal, sometimes the borrower says, okay, I have collected this 300 crores out of 1000 crore, I want to pay it back. So normally he should be allowed to pay it back to the banker. But the stand taken by the ED in most of the cases is no. It is now proceeds of crime because of being tainted money, and proceeds of crime have been attached, and only after the special court's order this property can be released. So now kindly see the wide disconnect. The purposive interpretation is lost. The whole objective is lost. The purpose was to safeguard the banker. But because of this purely academic stand having been taken at many cases, the banker is also, you know, at loss. He's flabbergasted. What is happening? I wanted to curtail my loss. Now rather my loss is being aggravated. So here some kind of correction is required in the approach. And that is why probably some amendment has been made in IBC, Insolvency Banking Code, by inserting section 32A. And friends, say I made that how the finance people or the advocates or the tax advocates who have knowledge of this can assist in terms of handling this PMLA matters. That is, they can, you know, help in identifying how the pursuits of crime can be computed by working on these parameters. That is, identifying the source, identifying the loan utilized, calculation of correct POC, valuation, proper financial, and then accounting, and then preparation of money trail, etc. So though there are many, still many more issues which we can be raised at this stage, but since I have taken already a lot of time and you might be having certain questions, but I will definitely say thank you very much for the wonderful and keen participation which you have given. And we have a very, very, you know, I would say able and enlightened panel with us. So you can raise any questions, and with the help of the benefit of, we can take the benefit of presence of Honorable Justice Manmohan, Amit Khemka ji, Aran Dash Saab. Aran Dash Saab has been former chairman of the Appellate Tribunal of PMLA. So, but brothers and sisters, and all the dignitaries, thank you very much for the wonderful, for the patient hearing which you have given to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ashwini ji. The session, as usual, was quite enriching. After the session, by all three speakers who gave different insights and different inputs, one thing, rather four things came, that how different acts are interwoven with each other. And it's very difficult to understand until unless there is an expert who can make you understand. We are quite obliged that all three of you have been able to clear the doubts which were there. Then another fact which has come forth is that the trails to all these issues is an important fact. But as they say, facts may speak lie, but circumstances don't. So even if there is anybody, God forbid, is under the loop, if he is rightly advised by the right person, he can always not worry on those issues. Now, since the topic was such, we amongst on this platform, as earlier said, we had Amit Khemka, who is again a member of your team, and we had his insights. He needs no introduction as such, but be that as it may, his knowledge is in this thing. We have amongst us Ma'am Rano Jain. We will be unmuting her for some time. Then we have Sujoy Kantawala. He again has good knowledge on this matter. Only two questions, thankfully, because we are running short of time, are there. And we will not take any further questions because, as we said, that Mr. Suresh Prabhu has taught us that if we have to succeed, the time should be strictly followed. Mahinder Singh says, the Supreme Court in many cases has held that reverse burden does not mean that there is no burden on the prosecution. It requires first primary burden be satisfied at the prosecution. What is your take on it? Ashwini ji?
Sir, I think we have I will definitely come back, but what I am saying, we have the benefit of presence of Honorable Justice Manmohan. He can also take questions whenever desired.
So I will. Anybody can do.
I'll begin. Look, I myself am saying, firstly, it aptly said, prosecution has to discharge its burden. I am rather one step ahead. But first of all, clarify the burden which has been shifted back. Only to that extent you can bind a person. And even to the extent it has been shifted back, then we have to take care of the guidance from the Honorable Supreme Court that prosecution cannot just wash off his hands. Otherwise, in a civilized society, it will be difficult to live. How can negative be proved by a person that you have not done anything wrong? Aap batao pehle maine kya wrong kiya hai? At least batao to sahi. Aur usme parameters evidence do so that I can dispel those arguments. So that is how I think in a democratic setup, in a civilized society, that is how the function should be done. I am of that.
And, I want to add here one thing.
Yes, sir.
Are you hearing me, Mr. Tareja?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You are hearing me, Mr. Tareja?
Yes, everybody is.
Not only Mr. Taneja, everybody is just.
I will just explain. If you see the definition, or if you see the section 24, where the person is charged with the offenses. First of all, the initial burden is with the IU or the ED that there must be some material. Then the words are the person is charged. Charge means that the charges are framed against him. It means that some legal person or the judicial officer has examined the case and charges are framed. Now there are two views. One view of ED is charge means charge sheet is filed. Another basically charge means he has been charged. Charge means the special court has seen the file, charges are framed, then the burden will shift to the accused party. Otherwise not. Otherwise, unless some material, prima facie material, totally against the accused is available on the face of the record, then it will shift to the accused. But initial burden is with the ED. Some material must be there against the accused party. Thank you.
Very right, sir.
Vikas ji, please unmute Sujoy Katawala also.
And Sujoy, I'm doing today.
He's a very immaculate speaker. You know, we have been on many TV channels together, you know.
SUJ.
And very, very sweet. I mean, he puts things in a very sweet voice and sweet manner.
Yes, you are right.
His personality, you know. And Anil Agarwal ji is there. He's coming by 9999, you know, your password for this.
Mr. Anil Agarwal deliberately said 9999 because he said that once he adds, it becomes 10,000.
Yes.
So that one extra inch, just like what they said that the Neil Armstrong, that extra foot created a different mankind. So just like I'm reminded of the July 1969.
He's on this law and he has been speaking at many seminars and webinars on this law. In fact, he is our inspiration in many things. You know, sir, I just wanted to add one more thing. You know, there are three parts of...
For my learned friends, Mr. Taneja has been kind enough to post the PPT on the chat box, but be that as it may, he will also send it on the on my WhatsApp. I will share it on the group, what we have beyond law of CLC. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what I feel is that in order to prove the offense of money laundering, there are three steps. One is that the scheduled offense should have taken place. The second is that some proceeds of crime must have been generated out of that scheduled offense. Now, and the person is being prosecuted. He has tried to utilize or demonstrate those proceeds of crime as untainted money or projected them as untainted money. Now, these are the three steps. I feel that presumption is only in respect of the third step.
Absolutely.
So far as the first two steps are concerned, the onus squarely is upon the enforcement directorate. The presumption can only come in when the scheduled offense is proven and then the proceeds of crime are proven, that these proceeds of crime have been generated out of that scheduled offense only. Then only the question of the money laundering will come in. So money laundering can be presumed and then the onus will shift on the accused to prove that he did not do it knowingly or he did not know about that these are the proceeds of crime, or whatever way he wants to disprove them. But I feel that this should be the right interpretation in and harmonious interpretation of Section 3 and Section 24, I suppose.
Sujoy, what is your take?
No, I fully agree with Justice Singh and Taneja ji and Khemka ji, who have very, very appropriately placed the relevant issues before all of us. And you see what happens, 24 is a multi kind of dimensional monster actually, according to me. Because what will happen is, this will give an AK-47 in the hand of the IO, the enforcement officer. Because there will be absolutely no burden on him. Everything is thrown on the person. And this act has got such wide reaching. Because as we know, the definition of proceeds of crime is and whosoever. So anyone and everyone, and now even lawyers' fees are being attached. we heard the you recently that even a lawyer's fees are being attached under this act. Now, so therefore, secondly, in fact, Taneja ji, time kam tha. I was thinking that ab Nikesh Tarathya and Shape kuch bolenge. Because now kindly see 45, how dangerously it was worded. Yes. That yes. means a person would never be entitled to bail. Fortunately, Justice Nariman, it came before him. He went up to Magna Carta and he has discussed beautifully written judgment. But again, then they brought an amendment to some of the other kind of from the back door creep into it. And therefore, Bombay High Court in Samir Bhujwal had to hold. So every time there is this jostling happening, and we as defense lawyers on this side continuously have to be aware and alert that what game is being played, so that ultimately the constitutional guarantee is being violated everywhere. That is the difficulty which we are facing with this.
I will also ask Mr. Anil Agarwal, so much praise has been said. We are quite sacrosanct that words coming from all these people regarding you, the insights from your side will also just give a good flip to the entire game.
Yeah, I subscribe to the views of the all learned speakers.
I think that is always called.
But yes. Dasar is also here. If we can unmute Dasar on this issue, we quite often discuss with him. Yes. Can you see him? Find him.
We are doing that. Meanwhile, we have Ma'am Raju Jain also. We are unmuting her. Arun Dash.
Because may I suggest one thing?
Yes.
I think this is a part one. We need part two. Yeah. And we need all. I think Mr. Kemka, Mr. Taneja and Justice Singh, I think we need to hear more from them. Really, I'm telling you. That this is a fascinating aspect. This law is a new law in that sense. It is developing. And I think we need a lot of more insight. So many things like ECIR copy is not given. Again, this background method of crawling and trying to again recreate those two twin conditions. Very, very interesting discussion. I think part two should happen very soon.
Taneja sahab, dekho Mr. Dash hai, I don't think.
Achha, koi baat nahi, fir next question
unmute
de lete.
Rano ji, you unmute Rano ji, please.
Rano ji, that's what I'm saying.
You can have the benefit of Sister Rano's presence.
Yeah. Very, very learned person. She was...
Yes, ma'am, it is an immense pleasure that you are on the platform. And the fact...
Thank you, Vikas ji. Please let me start. Thank you, Vikas ji. Thank you very much for recognizing my screen, you know. And it is always my pleasure. It is always, always my pleasure to hear to Ashwini, who is like my younger brother. Actually, this is... not my core subject, Benami and PMLA. I have all my life has practiced only income tax. But hearing to Ashwini and Amit Khemka ji, he is a very good orator. Offline also, I have been in touch for so long. I was listening all this deliberation like a student. Though I am practicing only income tax, but I know I'll be like, good. I'm enlightened a lot. And I really, really liked it. Don't want to add anything to the subject. And presence of Honorable Justice Manmohan was really, really something added to it. So I'm very thankful for this deliberation. And I agree with Mr. Kantawala that there has to be a second session. Definitely.
Yes.
No, it has to be.
Sister Rano was member in the tribunal. We were batchmates. And some of the orders which she wrote, authored from while sitting at Chandigarh bench, these are worth reading orders.
Thank you. Ashwini and me form a mutual admiration society, actually.
And she refused the NCLT.
I just say that once you say that it's a mutual admiration, but if it is a hollow admiration, then nobody would appreciate. But once good words coming forth from one another, from a learned person, is always appreciated. Kantawala, I am seeing that he's nodding his head. It is just like he says, my name is Kantawala, but I can appreciate the roses in and around me.
Sir, साइक्लोन से जूझ रहे हैं मुंबई में.
I am reminded tomorrow, somebody called me up that tomorrow we have a session on sports law and beyond, where we have Mr. Puneet Bali along with Yuvraj Singh, the former cricketer. Somebody said that he's in Bombay. How will he come out of the cyclone? I said that he played a hurricane knock of six sixes. He will also not worry about the cyclone. Mr. Kantawala, a few words from your side. We will also work out how the second session goes. What is your take on certain aspects?
No, that's what I said, that the way they all our friends have succinctly put up this issue and the hard work which Taneja ji has done preparing this PPT presentation and all, I really appreciate. But what happens is, this is such a niche kind of subject and it's such a developing law that we'll have to have a part two, because we need to hear Mr. Khemka, we need to hear Mr. Taneja, we need to hear Justice Singh again. See, for example, the Nikesh Tarachand Shah, I think the way Supreme Court has kind of entered into that issue and passed this remarkable judgment. But can we expect that in future, if something goes up to the Supreme Court, hamara aisa naseeb hoga and we'll find the same kind of judges? We all know how things are. Today morning, I'll tell you, on live law, there was one example where a matter was on VC, video conference, before Justice Arun Mishra. And he said, we are not interfering, dismiss. So the advocate had not muted the mic. And she told her client, oh, yaar, inko kuch sunai nahi deta hai, inhone aise dismiss kar liya. Justice Arun Mishra kehte hai, madam, humko sab sunai deta hai. Now, what does that mean? Ke humko sirf yahi sunai deta hai, what we want to hear. So it again is a luck of a client. And that's why it is known as special luck petition, not SLP, special leave petition, special luck petition, that it goes before an appropriate bench who will hear both sides and then pass a judgment. So we can't have Nikesh again and again. Coming back to the original request, that Vikas, why don't you request our learned friends that we should have part two of this?
We
should have part two.
So Joy, there is an identical provision in Companies Act, you know, as for section 45 of PMLA, and the petitions are pending in Supreme Court, that you just have to follow the judgment in Nikesh Tarachand Shah and strike it down. But for last almost 2 years, those petitions are not being taken up and people are rotting in jails only because of that 212(6). You know, so the problem, you are right, that we need hearing by the courts, I suppose.
Can we have the final overview from Honorable Justice Manmohan, because he has heard now all of us.
Yes. Just one word before we ask Justice Manmohan Singh to just give a final wrap off. Kantawala, time and again, you are citing a judgment. I'm only saying just two lines sum up of that judgment, because large number of participants would not be knowing that what was held. Everybody has understood that Justice Fariman has given a wonderful judgment. But what is held in that? Just two lines, then we will ask Justice Manmohan Singh. Hello.
See, section 45, as it then stood, before it was kind of, the twin conditions were quashed, was that, first of all, it was something like this only, that unless the learned judge is convinced of your innocence, basically in layman's terms, and the public prosecutor virtually gives his NOC, only then and then a person. So therefore, you ignore 439, you ignore what bail and not jail is the criteria, and you throw a person in jail without going through the normal. So therefore, what Supreme Court says, now you treat it under 439 as a regular bail application. And that is what, in short, Nikesh Tarachand Shah says. It is a very long judgment, but in short, it is this. It has paved the way for a lot of people who were hit by those twin conditions now to argue their bail applications under 439 is a normal bail application. I leave it now to Justice Singh.
Okay. Yes, I think Mr. Kantewala is right. He is right that whatever explanation is explained to us, you know, I think landmark judgment is given by Justice Rohinton Nariman as well as Honorable Mr. Justice Sanjay Kishan Kohl. They are basically parallel to the Criminal Procedure Court principles laid down. That judgment, according to Mr. Kantewala, that judgment has been murder. I personally feel, I know, let me first say one thing, that it's not a case of anybody that if the accused party is involved, he should not be dealt with very strictly. Everybody says he should be dealt with very strictly. At the same time, if the person is innocent, then basically he should not be harassed. And thirdly, basically I say, if the bench of the Supreme Court has given the judgment, we must have a respect for judgment. We cannot basically set aside the judgment in order to amend the, some explanation is given. Either this thing should be discussed in the parliament so that each and every party has its own view. Otherwise, I personally feel it is a disrespect to the judgment rendered by the Supreme Court. I totally agree. And all the complete 3 years, almost every day, I used to tell everybody that we want that each and every case of ED should be successful. But the point is, they have to do accordance with law, not otherwise. Otherwise, what will happen? People will not stop there. It is a matter of property. It is a matter of death and life of a person. He has to go to the High Court. He has to go to the Supreme Court. Each and everything will be examined by the courts. I say, I totally agree that judgment cannot be overruled by some agency or some authority or some officer. It cannot be done. If you want to do something, if you want to bring a new law, it has to be discussed in the parliament. Because you must think what is going on in the minds of the honorable judges. That after hearing, we have rendered the judgment, which is appreciated by every citizen of this country. And suddenly one day, one explanation has come and the judgment is overruled. This is not right. One single judgment. There are about many judgments. Justice Bakhru has given the judgment, which says if basically the person is acquitted, he will also acquit it under the PMLA. For that also, the explanation is given. With due respect, I say, if you want to amend the law, it is a welcome move to go to the parliament, repeal the entire act, no problem at all. If you want to say that if property is attached, possession will be taken immediately without any application. If the parliament will pass the law, we have to obey it. But the thing is, we should not disrespect of the judgment of the Supreme Court in this manner. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. We are all, it was an enriching session. We always have a session of around 1.5 hours. But the way it was for 2 hours, 15 minutes, we never realized that how the time just went off. It is just like, on an average, we have a movie which is engaging. It is for 2 hours, but sometimes once the movie like Padmavat, it's of 3 hours still. People don't realize that the movie, it was 3 hours. It was a wonderful session from everyone.
One minute, Vikas. Vikas, may I say this?
एक चीज मैं कहना चाहता था, एक चीज बस।
आप बोलिए तनेजा जी, बोलिए।
मेरे को एक इंसिडेंस याद है कि जस्टिस मनमोहन की कोर्ट में दो तरफ से दोनों पार्टियां आपस में लड़ रही थी, कुछ बातें हो रही थी, एलिगेशंस, काउंटर एलिगेशंस, एक्सटर्नल फोर्सेस, दिस प्रेशर, दैट प्रेशर। सर ने कुछ नहीं बोला किसी को। पीएमएलए का एक्ट रखा था, उठाया, बोला ये एक्ट, ये जानते हो क्या है? बोले जी एक्ट है ये। I will go by this, और उसमें कॉन्स्टिट्यूशन की बुक और साथ में पढ़ लेना। आप जो भी कहते रहो, मेरे को कुछ सुनाई नहीं दे रही। I will decide and pass my order by this only। मुझे कुछ आपकी फालतू बातें सुनाई ही नहीं दे रही हैं, ना मैं किसी और की फालतू बातें सुनूंगा। That's it। बस एक्ट वापस रख।
Because I just wanted to say one thing।
जल बना कर देखने लायक था।
To add to what Tanija ji says, I just want to say one thing। आपने पद्मावती पिक्चर का एग्जाम्पल दिया। पद्मावती पिक्चर सिर्फ एक पिक्चर था। ये एक नेटफ्लिक्स सीरीज का एग्जांपल दीजिए जहां पे हमको दूसरा पार्ट का इंतजार है।
नाइस पीपल आई थिंक।
सो थैंक यू एवरीवन, द सेशन वाज एज यूजुअल एंगेजिंग। दैट इज व्हाट आई हैव अ टेक, बिकॉज़ दे से फॉर अ मदर एवरी चाइल्ड इज गुड। सो वंस यू आर अ मॉडरेटर, यू फील दैट एवरी सेशन इज गुड। But be that as it may, the expressions which is coming forth of the video, as well as the expressions coming on the Facebook live, we feel that the session is good. Tomorrow we have another session which is quite interesting for a common man, including the lawyers and professionals. because we all know that marriages are made at heaven, but sometimes marriages do create a hell at the earth also. So how the things shape up? It's offenses relating to marriage, prevailing law in India, and response of court. And the speaker is Mr. Honorable Mr. Justice Kawalji Singh Ahluwalia, former judge of, he had been at three places because he's principally from our High Court, Punjab and Haryana High Court.
Yes, yes.
He went to Calcutta High Court and then to Rajasthan High Court. So we can all say, from on behalf of Beyond Law CLC and ULS Punjab University, do join that session. It will give insights, not to a lawyer, but every common man also. A common man, common woman, I would also say. So do stay connected. Tomorrow the session is at 5 p.m. Thank you, everyone, who have given the insight. We are indebted to...
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Justice Manmohan Singh, Ashwin Taneja Ji, R.N. Dash, Sujay Kantawala, Mr. Aseem Pandya, Madam... Rano Jain, then Mr. R.N. Dash, and all those parties, Mr. Anil Agarwal, and Mr. Amit Khemka. The list is so much that everybody has his own way. Like they say, each one teach one. Everyone has his contribution in his own way, contributing for the insights of knowledge. Everybody who is given the knowledge, everyone has given their own way of contribution. Everyone stay connected, stay blessed, and namaste to all, and God bless you all.